That's all we needed was three. And now we just pray the rest of y'all get saved before service. Man, you ought to be there when it saved my soul.
Oh.
lost some battles, church, but we won sometimes.
For the victory. Heavenly Father, I'd like to just say thank you for everything that you've done and all the things you've already made possible, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, I'd just like to say thank you for being with our family. Thank you for being with our friends, oh Heavenly Father.
Yes, Father.
Thank you for being in this place, oh Heavenly Father. Thank you for dealing with our issues, dealing with our hearts, dealing with our minds, and dealing with our souls, oh Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, as I stand before your people today, oh Heavenly Father, I ask that you empty me out, oh God. Just make me an empty vessel, oh Heavenly Father, and you fill me up with your spirit, with your word, and with your love, oh Heavenly Father.
Yes, Father.
Just let it come flowing out, oh Heavenly Father. Let your words be heard, not mine. Your daughter, son, in Jesus' name, I pray and say amen.
Amen. Glory to God.
If we don't get this technology working, we're going to be up here pretty short.
Glory to God.
I say short. Y'all doing all right this morning?
Yes, sir.
I do have a song for us this morning. So, we're gonna listen to this song. I usually email it to myself and I didn't email it this time. But as we get ready to listen to this song, yes, you too. I do not own the rights to this music. I'm not trying to make any financial gain or any profit from this music. It is only for entertainment and teaching purposes only. It is spiritual gain. Mm-hmm. All right. The name of this song, oh yeah, I'm going to make a small other disclaimer. We say we're free, so don't get shackled when this song is played. All right? That's why we got to help me. Ooh, thank you, baby. Because this isn't what you would quote unquote say is a spiritual or a gospel song.
All right.
Because a lot of people say, well, Carrie Underwood, who is Carrie Underwood? And then Ludacris? That's ludicrous to have Ludacris playing in the church. But is it? Are you just shackled and chained up by the name? Can you actually hear the actual phrase and the point of the words that's going to come out of Carrie Underwood's mouth?
All right.
Let's go ahead. That ain't the song.
Champion?
Yes, the champion.
YouTube is muted.
I'll be the last one standing. Two hands in the air, I'm a champion. You'll be looking up at me when it's over.
Yeah.
courage I possess through the trauma. H is for the hurt, but it's all for the honor. A is for my attitude, working through the patience. Money comes and goes, so the M is for motivation. Gotta stay consistent, the P is to persevere. The I is for integrity, innovative career. The O is optimistic, open and never shut. And the N is necessary, cause I'm never giving up. See, they ask me how I did it, I just did it from the heart. Trusting the competition, been doing it from the start. They say that every champion is all about his principles. Yeah.
Did you hear those words? He says, I'm invincible. I'm unbreakable.
My God.
I'm a champion. No matter what struggles or things I go through, I am a champion.
Yeah.
You may knock me down, but I will get up because I'm a champion.
My God.
Some people say that's a secular song. Is it secular? Is it a spiritual song? Can you feel that in your soul? Can you feel the things that you fight with every day try to put you to the ground?
Yeah.
And every time they hit you, you just get up and say, you know what? I'm a champion. I have been put in situations. The name of today's sermon is Pushing Through to Victory.
All right.
Pushing Through to Victory.
Glory to God.
We're going to come from Romans chapter 8. We're going to start at verse 35, and then we're going to read to 39.
All right.
Glory to God. And the word of God reads, listen to the words. It says, who shall ever separate us from Christ's love?
All right.
Shall suffering and affliction and tribulation, or calamity and distress, or persecution or hunger, or destitution or peril or sword? Listen to those questions.
Mm-hmm.
It says, even as it is written, for thy sake we are put to death all the day long. We are regarded and counted as sheep for the slaughter. And it says, yet amid all these things, we are more than conquerors. And we usually stop right there. It says we are more than conquerors, but listen to the conjunction put at the end of it. It says, and gain a surpassing victory through him who loved us.
All right.
That's on top of being a conqueror already.
Right.
Then he says, for I am persuaded beyond doubt, and am sure that neither death nor life, listen to the confidence that he has.
All right.
Nor angels, nor principalities, nor things impeding or threatening, nor things to come, nor powers. Listen to the stuff he keeps adding on top of it.
Right.
He says, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is the Christ Jesus our Lord.
Hallelujah. Glory to God.
Because problems will come. We must just know who is our original champion and trainer that's in our corner.
Right.
You see, oh, I had another video. I've been trying to find it all night. I stayed up to 3 o'clock with writing the sermon and everything, trying to get this video for us, but I could not find it. So I'm going to have to reenact it. It was these two MMA fighters, right? Somebody may have seen it somebody may have posted it from the church. It was two ladies. And they was fighting, oh man, they was fighting, they was getting it. But one, she was almost ready to fall out. You would have counted her out after these 30 seconds. She was wobbling, she was down on the ground, she was up against the fence. And she was keep getting hit. But you was like, why will you not throw in the towel?
Yeah.
throw in the towel. She is getting murdered. She's getting pummeled. She's on the ground. She's been on the ground. And the other girl just beating her. But then she gets back up. And she stumbles. She gets up against the wall. And when she gets up against the wall, she jumps back up. And then before you know it, the girl hits her one good time. Bam! And she falls to the ground. And you're like, she's out. It's over. But before you know it, the girl, she pops back up. And when she pops back up, the little girl, she's about the size of Jayana. The other girl, about the size of Pastor. The little girl, she pops back up. He's like, stop the fight. Stop the fight.
Yeah.
Stop the fight. But no. She gets back up and she starts to fight. And then she hits the big tall girl. Wham. Before you know it, the tall girl was on the ground. And then the little girl gets on top of her. Wop, 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 wop. Puts her in this hole. Then she says this number. Then you know what they do in MMA? They have to tap out. But through all of that, that's our life, y'all.
Yeah.
That's how we are in life. That's how we are in battle. That's how we are in fight. In the suffering, in the affliction, in the things that go on in our life, they think they got us counted out. But we have a champion and a trainer in our corner that prepares us for battle.
Right.
He prepares us for those situations. And when we down on the ground, he says, get up.
Yeah.
Get up. Don't let the situation that looks bigger than you overtake you.
Right.
Just because the situation is up here and you down here don't mean that you have to get overtaken by it.
All right.
Because it's going to keep coming. When she was on top of her, when the big girl was on top of her, she didn't give up. She didn't let up. The big girl didn't. And neither did the small girl give up.
All right.
So in our life, when those things are constantly coming, we can't. We can't tap out. We can't concede because we are bigger than our opponent. God has made us bigger. God has made us greater than
Amen.
Our opponent.
Amen.
See, during boxing, there's a couple of things you have to do to get trained and get ready for that. Because it's the training. We have to evaluate your competition. And where am I going with this? See, because when you start to fight, boxers don't start fighting their opponent the day they sign the contract or the day they say, I'm getting ready to fight you.
Mm-hmm.
No. You see, because when they say, I'm going to fight you, sometimes that fight is almost a year away. Mm-hmm. Sometimes 6 months away. You may ask, well, why? Because there's a training process.
Right.
All right.
And in that training process, first you have to evaluate your competition.
Yeah.
You see, by evaluating your competition, you know what their weaknesses is and you know what their strengths are. But you know, in the same evaluation period, you find out what your strengths are and what your weaknesses are.
Mm-hmm.
And so some of your opponents may be long-winded. They may go 10 rounds. If you only used to going 5 rounds, you got to get some training in. You got to get your cardio up. You got to get your dodging up. You got to get your juking up. You got to get something up.
All right.
Because if not, you're going to get whoa out.
That's right.
Some of them are fast. Some of them are sprinters. They come in there, wah, 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 wah. Then they step on back. But you have to know, can I take a bunch of punches? Or do I need to bob? Do I need to wave?
All
right. That's part of the evaluation.
All
That's
right.
part of your training. Where am I going? You see, because they just don't come by themselves.
Right.
See, let's go. Romans chapter 8, verse 35.
All right.
We're going to try to touch on 3 things today. We're going to try to touch on our evaluation period, our training period, and then our fighting and execution plan. We're going to try to get through it. I think we can.
Amen.
Amen. Romans chapter 8, verse 35 reads, who shall ever separate us from Christ's love? That's a question right there. Mm-hmm. Who shall ever separate us from Christ's love? Because here come all our opponents. Suffering is one opponent. But you see, they don't just roll by themselves.
Right.
Our problems just don't roll by themselves. Then we got affliction and tribulation. In math, that would be shell plus affliction plus tribulation. Plus, then we're going to see it's going to start putting some algebraic form up there. Or calamity and distress. Y'all see this stuff? It's multiplying now. Come it's going to try to start to divide. Or persecution, or hunger, or destitution. You know my country tongue get twisted up sometimes. Or peril, or sport. They just started coming up with a whole bunch of things. Training.
Because some of our training knows, and some of our opponents, tribulation knows, you know what? If I let suffering take care of him for a little while, he may break down a little bit.
Yeah.
Then I just wait and take my time because, you know, suffering gonna bring his homeboy and his brother affliction.
Right.
You see, tribulation just sitting there standing in the cut. He just waiting because soon as maybe if one of them get taken care of, then when I come in, I'm really gonna knock him out.
All right.
See, because listen to this definition of suffering. It says the state of undergoing pain, distress, or hardship. It's the state of undergoing pain. It's not pain, but it's the state of undergoing pain.
My God.
Wow. There's some distress over, and listen to affliction. It says something that causes pain or suffering.
My God.
Something that causes the pain or suffering. So then I can have affliction with the suffering, but can I have suffering without affliction?
Mm.
Oh, my word. Listen to those concepts. Can you? Mm-hmm. Or can you just go through one?
All right.
Something that causes pain or suffering. Listen to tribulation. Mm-hmm. A cause of great trouble or suffering.
Right.
A cause.
Yeah.
A cause. A cause. What in our life are causes of our tribulations? Because some of our tribulations come from some of the things we used to do and try to upkeep to make ourselves holy.
All right.
Can some of our tribulations come from inner depths of our soul that we don't even know? Can we cause our own self-suffering? Because sometimes we only try to look at outside suffering, but sometimes we make ourselves suffer inside when nobody even's around.
Amen. All right.
Calamity. It says it's an event causing great and often sudden damage or distress or disaster.
Mm.
And so, you see how your opponents try to just stack up on you?
All right.
They try to make it look like you don't have no way out. They try to make it look like I'm going to keep beating you and beating you until you give up. Why do we have to read this? Because we're preparing for something, right?
Right.
We're preparing to be the victors. We're not preparing to be the ones that's tapping out. But all of this stuff is a part of the training ground.
All right.
Couple of more. Distress.
Yeah.
It says extreme anxiety, sorrow, or pain. Any of us going through some distress right now?
Mm.
Any anxiety? Mm-hmm. Any sorrow? Any pain?
Mm.
See, some of these things start to just come together, and you're like, I didn't even know I was dealing with that.
Yeah.
But once you started spitting out those definitions, is that what I'm going through?
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes we have to go to the doctor to get a diagnosis to see what's wrong with us.
All right.
I had to say that to my wife. But that's a whole nother story. Because we do. That's the Lord speaking to me in my own service.
Yeah. Praise God. Amen.
He always speaks to me, but that little excerpt there, I didn't know that was going to come out. I'll give y'all a little inside scoop in a minute. All right. Persecution.
All right.
It says it's hostility, ill treatment, especially because of race, political, and listen to this one, religious beliefs.
Wow.
Religious beliefs.
My God.
So we got the world in there, we got the flesh in there, and we got God in there.
Mm.
All in persecution. And sometimes we are all persecuted because of all three of those things.
Right.
And hunger. It says a feeling or discomfort or weakness caused by the lack of food coupled with the desire to eat. You say that's just a physical thing. That's just a fleshly thing. No, it ain't. That's a spiritual thing too.
All right.
Because sometimes we have a spiritual hunger, but we don't want to feed it sometimes. No, and that's the only thing that can suffice spiritual hunger is some spiritual food. But sometimes we'll get piled up on that good dressing, that good sweet potato pies, or good chest pies, that good turkey, and all that good stuff, you know?
All right.
But then we won't put time. I think we spent a lot of time cooking yesterday. Oh, day before. But do we ever put that much time into learning and eating God's word?
Yeah, you already know, yeah.
Sometimes it takes us 20, 30 minutes to pick some greens. Then it takes you about 2-3 hours for them to cook real good. But you watch that pot. You watch that pot. Because you want to make sure the water don't go down. You want to make sure the flavoring's good. You want to make sure everything's good in those pots.
Right.
Do we make sure everything's good with us?
My God.
Make sure we get that spiritual food, that spiritual nourishment to make sure things can keep going. And when we do get into our fight, we don't get it overexerted.
Yeah. All right.
You don't start running 10 miles when you haven't even ran five blocks? One block.
Yeah.
I ain't ran one block in so many years, but it's the same principle.
All right.
So we have to start training. Almost done with the definitions, I promise you. Destitution.
All right.
It says poverty so extreme that one lacks the means to provide for oneself.
Wow.
It's a poverty so extreme. That means you're not only trying to feed your kids. You can't even feed your kids. You can't even feed yourself.
Right.
You can't provide for yourself. Peril.
All right.
Serious or immediate danger. And the sword, we know what the sword is. Serious and immediate danger with peril. Sometimes the Lord would put us in situations.
All right.
To see our reaction and how things are going to come about. Sometimes it's our job, sometimes it's just driving on the freeway.
All right.
Do you trust God enough? I know I trust God enough every day when I drive to work. Because right. I'm going at every bit of 80, 85 miles an hour every day when I go to work. I may drop down to 70 when it's raining. Maybe.
Wow.
Okay.
Will I stop and take heed when things are put in front of me? These are all of our opponents.
All right.
All of our opponents, we have to start measuring our opponents up.
Yeah.
Who's the opponent in our life? Some of these opponents take on human form. Some of these opponents will try to take you through all of that at one time.
All right.
Question is, are we ready to fight?
My God.
Are we ready to fight? The name of that song was The Champion. Are you ready to be a champion?
Wow.
Are you ready to be invincible? Are you ready to be unbreakable?
All right.
Are you ready to conquer when things look like they cannot be conquered? Are you ready to sit and fight for what you know and what you believe and what you love?
Yeah. All right.
Are you ready to gain and strengthen your faith in God? To know everything that he puts in front of me, he has equipped me with to fight and get through.
All right.
That's what a champion does. We just don't run into battle not knowing and sizing up our opponents.
Yeah.
He's going to train us. He's going to make us ready for it.
All right.
Just because things line up don't mean it's time to give up.
All right.
Verse 36 says, even as it is written, says, for thy sake we are put to death all the day long.
All right.
We are regarded and counted as sheep for the slaughter.
My God.
You may say, man, that's just hard. You think it's hard? Life is hard.
Mm-hmm.
How do you know good days if you don't have bad days? That's part of life.
All right.
How do you know what it feels like to be healthy if you ain't never been sick? That's part of life.
Mm-hmm.
How do you know how to get through troubles if you never been through troubles? That's part of life.
Yeah.
Your opponents are going to make sure you experience all of it.
Mm-hmm.
But it's going to be up to you to get through all of it. Mm-hmm. Y'all should have stopped me. Y'all should have corrected me. It ain't up to you.
Come on.
It ain't up to me. Thank you. It's up to God to get us through it. Because he's the one that's going to equip us. You never get a trainer. You don't get a trainer that don't know what they're doing.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you do,
you're going
to get whooped. You see, there we go. All right. Wait. Move it too fast. All right. Let's go to, let's start training. Yeah. Let's go ahead and Romans chapter 8, verse 37. It says, yet amid all these things,
all right,
we are more than conquerors and gain a surpassing victory through him who loves us. He said, through all things, go back to 36. 35. Back to the top. I want y'all to count with me all these things.
All right.
Suffering is what?
One.
Affliction is what?
Two.
Tribulation is what?
Three.
Calamity is what?
Four.
Distress is what?
Five. Six.
Seven.
Eight.
Nine.
Ten.
Now drop back down. All those things. All those things. If we added all those up. Those are 10 things.
All right.
That try to stand in our way. To try to test our faith. Those are 10 things. When one of them takes a break, the other one is right there behind to jump in. When the other one tries to take a year-long vacation, there's a whole nother 9 in there to jump right on in.
Yeah.
There's 10 of them there. If 5 of them even take a day off, there's 5 more right there to jump in their place.
My God.
If 9 of them took the day off, it's still 1 of them right there to be a thorn in your side.
My God.
So in training, we have to prepare for all of it. When a boxer get into the ring, even though his opponent may only last 5 rounds, he still trains for 10.
Right.
He may get in the ring and knock his opponent out in 10 seconds, but he trains just as though it was going to go for 10 rounds.
Right.
Sometimes we go through seasons in our life, we think everything is great, but you have to know your opponent is right there waiting.
Right.
You have to know, even though everything is great in my life right now, I have to keep training as though 10 rounds is coming up.
All right.
The boxing arena is set up with 4 corners. But only 2 corners have attendance in them.
All right.
You say, well, why only 2 corners have attendance? Because the trainers are in each corner to take a look at how you're fighting, and also to take a look at how your opponent's fighting.
My God.
The other 2 are empty because those are like neutral places in your life. But see, at every ringing of the bell, you go to your corner. And when you go to your corner, the trainer sits there and tell you, hey, he is hitting you low. He hits 1-1-2, bam, he hits you right in your stomach. 1-1-2, bam, right in your stomach. And every time you fall for it. So the trainer tells you, when you see 1-1-2, you bob to the side. Then when you bob to the side, he's gonna miss your stomach, and I want you to come in with an uppercut. So that's what a good trainer will tell you to do.
All right.
But if you have a bad trainer in your corner, he's just gonna say, oh, here's some water, here's some Vaseline, because now when he hits you, he's just gonna slide off of you. Who want a trainer like that?
Wow.
No, I need a trainer that's gonna tell me how. We done already practiced. We done already evaluated. Yeah. We done already seen what the pattern is. That's what God is. That's what Jesus is. He's our trainer. He's going to let you know. Now this, I done already showed you. I done told you what's going on. He's going to hit you with some persecution. He's going to hit you with a little affliction. But when he tried to bring that tribulation in to make you feel sorry about all that persecution and affliction he done tried to put you through, I need you to bob to the side. I need you to just bob to the side, get on one knee and call on me. And then when you do get in trouble, get on the ropes for a little bit. Wait till the round is over. Then come to my corner. and ask me what's going on.
All right.
Let me give you the advice I know that will help you beat this opponent of yours.
That's right.
The training. 1 Timothy chapter 1. We're going to read 1 Timothy chapter 1. Not going to be up here long.
Glory to God.
1 Timothy chapter 1, we're going to read verse 4. We're going to start at verse 4. Yeah, we're still going to start at verse 4. Because I'm not going to go to verse 3. But listen to some of the things that try to get in our way while we try to train. It says not to give importance or to occupy themselves with legends. He's talking to them. Paul is talking to Timothy about the church and about the people and not the things not to let your people get all caught up with. Because you see, when we're trying to get trained, some of this stuff will try to get in our way to keep us away from the actual plan and the actual goal at the end.
All right.
Say, occupy themselves with legends. Some people in your group are going to try to tell you and get you away from the actual word of God. Because what does legends and fables and myths have to do with the power of God? Nothing. What does legends, fables, and myths have to do with your fight to get through persecution? And endless genealogies, which foster and promote useless speculations and questions rather than acceptance in faith of God's administration and the divine training that is in faith. Because through all of that, the training in faith is what's getting stronger. The
all
training
right.
in faith, because all the stuff we talked about earlier is the stuff it's going to build your faith. It's going to build it, all this good stuff. Look at genealogies, which foster, listen to this, and promote useless speculations. What do speculations have to do with God? It makes you question rather than the acceptance of faith of God.
All right.
It makes you question. See, you try to give somebody some real Jesus, you try to give somebody some real God, then they'll bring something else on you. So, was Jesus the second born or the first born in his family? So was he John's brother? Was he Paul's uncle? So what was he? So was John actually related to Jesus? Yeah. But I'm trying to give you salvation. I'm trying to give you love. I'm trying to give you the cross. But you want to contend with me on all this other stuff?
Wow.
I'm training for something greater. I'm training to get my faith up, but you want to get me all tripped up with all this other nonsense. You're trying to make the water muddy.
All right.
You don't want me to see the crystal clearness of the love of God. You don't want to see the crystal clearness of being unchained. You don't want to want me to see the crystal clearness of God. You want me to sit and try to get on all these rules and try to look good, try to look holy, and try to do all that stuff, but what was the initial plan? What's the initial goal? Jesus and God and salvation is the initial goal.
All right.
We get all mixed up with all this other stuff and we get lost. Because it's all about our divine training that is in faith. We go up in that leaning of the entire human personality on God is absolute trust and confidence.
All right.
The entire human personality on God in absolute trust and confidence. Do you have absolute trust and confidence that God, Jesus, is training you the right way? That's going to make a difference in a minute. Do you have the confidence?
Right.
Do you have the trust? How many of us actually, honestly trust in God for everything that we do?
Everything.
Say amen.
Amen.
All right. Okay. And understand. Be honest. Because it's a lot of stuff we still trying to get there, because training is all about getting prepared, all about getting ready.
Oh, yeah.
It's no shame if you're not ready. If you don't have full trust, that's why we training.
Yeah.
If you don't have absolute confidence, that's why you training. That's what, because it says the entire human personality. The entire human personality, what in your human personality always wants to be godly all the time?
Wow. That's a whole nother sermon, ain't it?
Because the human personality itself always fights against God's absolute trust and confidence. And that's what those other 10 always want you to fight against as well.
That's right.
They said, because if I put you through enough affliction, you're going to stop trusting in God.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
That's right.
If I make you hungry enough, you're going to pray to God to God feed you or send you some food. But what happens if he don't? You say it again, sister. You still got to trust in it.
Right.
If Jesus can go out for 40 days and not eat a lick of a morsel of something, you can too. It's all about our training in the faith. The faith is what's going to get us through. Faith, you know, pastor's been really teaching us a whole lot of awesome stuff.
Amen.
You know, because freedom, me and my wife, we talked, and I told my wife, I said, freedom comes with a great responsibility.
Oh, yeah.
And she was like, what do you mean? So she said, freedom, the responsibility of freedom is so powerful that let me reword that. Because with freedom, you have freedom itself.
Mm-hmm.
And with freedom, there's no per se boundaries, but there is.
Right.
Mm-hmm. See, because within freedom, the responsibility of having it is knowing not to overstep or go outside of the lines.
Right. All right.
Not saying that you are in bondage or in chains, but there are still certain places you still cannot proceed to just because you are free.
All right.
That's right. That's right.
Because there was things that we as a family stopped doing because of places that we were.
All right.
There was things I stopped doing because of places that we were.
All right.
When I was told I was free, I had a lot of things put on me. Because today I can say I'm free.
Amen.
Amen.
Something just as simple. We're at a place where it's saying you shouldn't adorn yourself. So you have to stop wearing a lot of things. And you know, then we started learning and getting free of and understanding what Jesus is and what God is.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, a little at a time, I started wearing a necklace. Then I started, you know, I always wore watches. I couldn't get rid of my watches. But we couldn't wear this and that. We couldn't wear braces. We couldn't wear chains. We couldn't wear this because it was adorning yourself. You wasn't doing things right.
All right.
How would people look at you? You could only wear a wedding band. And this is not to talk bad about any other organization, but when the Lord showed me through Pastor,
thank you. Freedom, Lord.
What freedom is.
Glory to God.
Amen.
Praise his name.
Amen.
I'm going to say this right quick and we're going to jump right back in there. Because all this has to do with the victory that the Lord has given me.
Yeah.
Amen. Of being free. I haven't worn an earring in over maybe 20 years. Y'all may say, man, that's petty, Jesse. It's not. Because I enjoy wearing my earring. I wasn't gay.
Right.
You know, it was just a part of who I was. I put this earring in. I bought it yesterday. But the Lord said, you're free, son. You don't have to worry about what people are going to say about you because you're free.
All right.
It's been over 20 years, I know. Because I would joke with my family, I would joke with them, and I'll always say, well, I can't do that. I have to worry about my perception, or what the perception, what other people would think of me as being a minister up on stage with an earring in your ear. Because for so long it was, you can't do it because that's not a godly thing to do.
Right.
Who was to say that? It's not biblical about that, because then, you know, I'm doing classes and stuff, it teaches you that things have been culturally done for years.
Oh, yeah.
And only because of the barriers and the stigma of certain things, it was put as a no, or it's a can't, or a rule that that's not a godly thing to do.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I'm so sorry, y'all.
Glory to God.
But it's freedom. Knowing he's given me victory over being chained. Jesus is the purpose. You should be able to look through me and see Jesus.
Right.
You should be able to look through me and see the cross.
Right,
you should be able to look through anybody that has a word of God, that's a word of God straight from the Bible, and see Jesus. Don't worry about this earring in my ear. After the sermon, it shouldn't be Minister Chase was up on stage preaching a sermon with the earring in his ear. Were you more focused on the earring, or were you more focused on the word of God?
All right.
Amen. Praise God.
But I had to go through all that stuff to know that what true freedom is.
Right.
For me, it was the little earring, but to somebody else, it could be something else.
Right. Glory to God.
Amen.
Just say, thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
1 Timothy chapter 1, verse, chapter 4. No, 1 Timothy chapter 4. I'm going to start at verse 7.
Yeah.
It says, but refuse and avoid irreverent legends. Almost the same thing that it just said.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Profane and impure and godless fictions. Mm-hmm. Mere grandmother's tales. Mm-hmm. See, that stuff I was dealing with came from all this.
Yeah.
Godless fictions. You can't do this. That's a godly fiction.
All right.
It was put in, you couldn't find it nowhere in the Bible. It was a fiction. You was trying to put God's stuff on fictitious stuff.
Right.
You can't base your life on fictitious things that are godless.
Right.
All right.
And silly myths, and express your disapproval of them. Go up. It's going to say train yourself toward godliness. Godliness is more than godlessness.
Right.
All right now. It says the part to keeping yourself spiritually fit.
All right.
See, spiritually fit is the thing we always have to attain and try to attain or get, being spiritually fit. Because it's going to help us with all that other crap that's going to keep coming towards us, because it's not going to stop.
Mm-hmm. My God.
Say, for physical training is of some value. Useful for a little. It's good.
Yeah.
It keeps your heart pumping. It keeps the weight off. You know, keeps the blood flowing. It's good for a little bit.
Right.
But godliness.
My God.
Spiritual training is useful. Listen to this. It's useful. It's more than just useful. Because you see, this just stopped, right? Some sense of value, comma.
Right.
But then watch. After this, it's going to add some stuff on there. It says it's useful and of value in everything. And in every way. For it holds promise for the present life and also for the life which is to come.
Yeah.
Amen.
Listen to all that great stuff when you spiritually train.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Because right now, when you spiritually train, you don't know sometimes you don't know what you're just evaluation and what you're training for.
Right. All right.
What do I have to get over? What's in my life that I'm training for? A lot of us like to put a lot of stuff on financial stuff, but it's financial is only going to get you so far.
Yeah.
Because when you don't have nothing, when you don't have two pennies to rub together, the spiritual training is going to get you through.
Yeah.
All right.
Everything that we do, and in every way, where it holds promise for the present life, the promise of this present life, and also life which is to come.
Yes, sir.
Because that life which is to come, we fight for it every day. I don't know who here has a perfectly serene job. Everybody love going to work every day?
Two I go.
Huh?
Just the two I go.
Because if I had it, I know I wouldn't work every day. But see, we have to work every day, but we need to work every day the same way with the spiritual training.
Right. Yeah.
But love our spiritual training that we're getting. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it may be hard. Yeah, it may be kind of... Whoever gains muscle only lifting 2-pound dumbbells. If you lift 2-pound dumbbells for 20 years, you gain nothing. You have to constantly go up on your weight. Constantly.
All right.
Because if not, you don't gain nothing. If not, you don't produce any muscle. Because we like to, because you know, fat comes like that.
Right.
It takes so long to gain muscle, but so short time to put a lot of fat on us. Why do I go there? Verse 9. About 10 more minutes, people. 10 more minutes and we be done. Say for the verse 8 says, for physical training is of somewhat useful for a little. But godliness, spiritual training is useful and valued in everything and every way, for it holds promise for the present life and also for the life which is to come. Then verse 9 says, this saying is reliable and worthy of complete acceptance by everybody.
All right.
It is. It's reliable. And it's worthy. And it should be completely accepted by everybody. Say, with a view of this, we toil and we strive. Yes, and suffer reproach. Because we have fixed our hope on the living God, who is the Savior, preserver, maintainer, deliverer of all men, especially of those who believe, trust in, and rely on, and adhere to.
All right.
See, as we eat spiritual food, as we eat spiritual training, as we gain, as we get tougher, we may suffer the reproach.
All right.
This we toil and we strive. We have to toil and strive to get that power.
All right.
Yes, and we may suffer because we have fixed our hope. We fixed our hope. Have you fixed your hope? We fix our hope on the living God. Because in our corner, look over there, that's who's there.
All right.
He's going to train you because when he trains, he's going to let you know, I'm your Savior.
Right.
Come to me, come in the corner. I'm going to let you know I'm your Savior. You're going to persevere because I've taught you how to persevere. You're going to be a maintainer because I've taught you how to maintain. You're going to be you're a deliverer because I've taught you. I've showed you who a true deliverer is.
My God.
Of all men, especially of those who believe. We done trained on faith. So you can believe.
All right.
Because we done trained on that faith so you can believe because then I want you to trust in. Trust in, not trust on, but trust in God. There's a difference in the in and the on. Trust in, and then I want you to rely on me. Be in me, then you can hang on me when times get tough. And adhere to him. Who are we going to adhere to? Our trainer, God.
All right.
That's who we're going to adhere to. Because if we adhere to anybody else or anything else, it's going to fall. It's not going to be strong. It's not going to be positive. It's not going to be good. And then as we get ready to finish. We have to do the fight then.
All right.
After we've been trained, after we've been evaluated, we've been trained, it's time to fight.
Right.
Because part of the game plan is you always have to find out the strengths, the weaknesses, and then how you're going to take advantage of the strengths and the weaknesses of your opponent and the strengths and weaknesses of yourself. But with the proper training, we get the proper confidence and strength in God.
All right.
Romans chapter 8, we're going to read verses 38 then 39. Says, for I am persuaded. Listen to the confidence that he has after doing and going through all those 10 or knowing about those 10 opponents up top. Says, for I am persuaded beyond doubt and am sure that neither death nor life. Listen to the strongest of these words. Says, for I am persuaded beyond doubt. How did he get persuaded beyond doubt? He was trained. His trainer was a good trainer. His trainer showed him the stuff. You don't go into a test, never study before, and be confident in your test. And that's a problem. It's a difference when you know you've studied for like 3-4 hours straight on a certain test. You go into that thing more confident and courageous than when you only study 5 minutes when you pulled up and you're getting ready to jump out and go to the classroom and take your final. No, you only have this confidence because of the training you went through.
All right.
He says, for I am persuaded beyond doubt. He says, I'm sure neither death nor life. That's how strong that is. Nor angels, nor principalities, nor things impending or threatening, nor things to come, nor power. Listen to all the confidence. Do we have that confidence today? If we don't, we need to train hard.
All right.
If we don't, we need to have persuaded neither death nor life. Wow. That's my song. Why persuade? The change is gonna come. That's the Lord said. The change is gonna come today. The change is gonna come because we're gonna train and we're gonna be. We're gonna have the assurance that death or life can stop us.
Amen.
Can stop us from beating affliction, from beating tribulation, impending or threatening our things to come. No power.
All right.
Is gonna overpower me. Think about being down on the ground, that little bitty, I call it a little bitty girl. And she gets up. She did not stay down. Oh, I wish I had it, because it was awesome. And listen, it says, nor height nor depth.
Right.
Depth. Because some things get too high for us, and we say, we can't do it.
Yeah.
Some of us are scared of heights right now. Some of, she ain't here today. My girl, Sydney. She used to be afraid of flying. But she has conquered her fear. Yes. Dude, nor depths. Some people don't like swimming now today because they're scared of drowning. Right now today. Nor anything else. So do you have enough confidence as a person that's 45, 55, 65 years old and ain't never swam the day in your life, go jump off a 10-foot diving board into the 10 feet?
No.
But we gonna get there.
Training.
You ain't training. Start in the 2 feet, jump off. Start in the 5 feet. Then build your confidence up.
Yeah.
I tell you, it's nothing more exhilarating from diving off of a diving board, diving platform, all the way down to a 10 feet. That, try it. One time. It is awesome.
Yeah.
You don't know freedom and the flicker between life and death right there in your, and you just see it and you feel the exuberation. You hit the water. You go down deep.
That's right.
But you come back up. And then you take that deeper breath. Oh man, it's so awesome. You gotta try once.
Right.
But this, the confidence, that's how we have to have confidence in God.
Yeah.
In our fights, we have to have that confidence. So nor anything else in all of creation, whatever else is in creation, I know God's got me.
Yeah.
I've trained right. He's given me the tools. He's equipped me with the stuff to actually do it. As he said, you're more than conqueror and you're going to surpass it. You're going to have victory over all this stuff. He says creation will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
All right.
That is it right there. Because through all that training, there's nothing that can separate you if you got the right person and the champion in your corner.
All right.
Why veer from what we know is good? Why would we veer from something, someone that we know have our best interests at hand and our best interests at heart? When we start going through those fights, start going through those battles, we see the seconds on the clock. We know we got 5 seconds. Get to our corner.
All right.
Ask your champion, what do I do? What should I do? And he's going to tell you what to do, and he's going to tell you one simple thing, too. We've been training for this our whole life. I've trained you. I put the right stuff in you to get through all of those adversaries that's trying to put you down.
Mm-hmm.
All those adversaries that's trying to keep you shackled. All those adversaries that's trying to tell you you just ain't enough. All those adversaries, I prepared you for it. You already are a conqueror. You are a conqueror once you stepped into the ring of life.
Yes, sir.
And I've made you victorious. I just need you to fight it out to the end. Mm-hmm. Don't give up. When you get a knee down on the ground, get it back up. Mm-hmm. Long as you ain't on your back and ain't been counted out for your 10 seconds, you still got time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because you are a champion.
Yes, sir.
He breeds champions. He tells we can get through it. It's the victory that he's given us to get it done. No one gives up their life for losers.
Amen.
God didn't give up his life for losers.
Amen.
He gave up his life for champions, for winners.
All right.
You know we have it. We just got to do it and get through it. It's not a bond.
Amen.
Glory to God.
I had one more scripture, but I'm going to be done. Heavenly Father, I'd like to just say thank you for everything
yes,
that you have said today, oh Heavenly Father. Just thank you for equipping us, oh Heavenly Father. Thank you for training us, oh Heavenly Father. Thank you for making us invincible, oh Heavenly Father. Thank you for just being in our ear and being in our corners at all times, oh Heavenly Father. Thank you for giving us that strength, the perseverance to keep going through and getting up. Even though the things look hard, the things look like we're going to be beaten, and not come out victorious. Thank you for letting me be us to be able to see, Heavenly Father, your great will, your great power, and your great confidence in us, oh Heavenly Father. Thank you for strengthening our faith. Thank you for strengthening our walk, oh Heavenly Father. Thank you for everything that you've done, all the things you made possible, and all those things that are to come. Your only Son, Jesus' name, we pray and we say amen.
Amen. Amen.